All right, I'm doing a live video right now for those people wondering why I'm all so dolled up right now. Well, it's Friday. Well, it's just another Friday actually for us, but because I will be having my surgery next Friday and my surgery will be on Friday, February 12th. So, we decided to have our date night tonight. And so my loving husband, brought me to, hold on, let me just check something. My loving husband brought me for dinner tonight, at our favorite place in Midtown, and we haven't been there for a very long time because of the COVID, but we're able to go have our dinner date there. Tonight we were in the patio, thankfully, because my loving husband is being hey Alan, hello, been having, you know, was worried about like me getting the COVID, because if I got COVID before my surgery date, it will be so bad. First of all, I'm not gonna have my surgery, or second, if it didn't happen right now and it happened while I'm doing recovery, it will be so bad. So it will be very bad recovery. So we had a great time. We were there for not long, but we had a great time, you know, having dinner and everything. I don't know how many people I see some people watching, but I don't know who are they watching, but whoever y'all watching, hello, welcome to my live video. Okay, maybe all of y'all are wondering while I'm doing live video, like what I said there on my post, that a lot of people are asking and questions. Oh, Mr. Alvin, yes, I hope so too. I am okay right now, a little bit. I'm really good in hiding my pain, actually. I'm hanging in here. Mr. Alvin, say hi to your beautiful girls and your wifey. I miss them. So anyway, my reason of my video is to explain about my TMJ and how it'll happen and when it started, and you know, because a lot of people are asking me how did it all started, your TMJ, because people always think like TMJ is such like not really that serious. It's like, I don't know, some people think it's not a serious thing, but it actually is, especially for me, because I kept ignoring it before. So okay, I'm just waiting for some people who wanted to join me about on this live video, and if you have any questions, let me know, write it down, I will answer it. This is my Friday night before my surgery date next Friday. Miss Tia was talking about you yesterday. We all miss you. Oh, I miss Miss Tia. Oh my God, I haven't seen her for like a long time. And oh my gosh, your girls are so big now. Oh my goodness. I can imagine. They were so little when the first time I met them. I remember back in Regency. Like, man, like 8 years ago, 9 years ago? Oh my God, they were like, I feel so old. But anyway, okay, I'm just waiting. Somebody will join me with this Facebook Live. I was doing a video a while ago. Then my husband came up here in the restroom to do something, and then I stop it and I'm like, you know what, I'm just gonna do a live video. just like get over it. But anyway, I'm gonna start in a few. I hope everybody's having a good Friday. Right now, it is. I'm missing a few events the past few months, unfortunately, because of the COVID. I really, really miss my friends. Just an update, because I know I'm gonna have my surgery next Friday. So I've been eating everything that I want the past 2 weeks until Wednesday, next Wednesday. So I've had steak. I have steak before, but I cannot always eat steak because it's, you know, like it has to be really, really tender, and it kind of like hurts me after. So I try not to. Burger, not much, because you know I have to open my mouth really big, and then like very chewy, so it's not really good. It's really good, but it's painful after. But lately I've been having everything that I've not been eating, mainly because I know I wanna be able to have that for a long time, and I will be on liquid diet I think for 4 to 6 weeks. Yep, it's gonna be a long time. They will wire, they said that they're gonna put wire on my mouth. They will wire it shut for 4 to 6 weeks, maybe 8, and then they will only put a little bit of a like a opening on it, so I could put maybe a straw smoothie, protein shake maybe. But I know for sure that I will be losing those COVID weight. So I'm fattening myself up more. It's not like I'm gonna get really, really more fat. But anyway, all right. To answer all the questions, all my friends that been like messaging me, and friends like clients also, people that I've seen lately, asking me, what is TMJ? It's called temporomandibular joint disorder. And it's locking of the jaw. In short, it's called TMJ or TMD. It's a disorder, like locking of the jaw. My problem is my left jaw is locked close. It's fucked up, unfortunately. So, to start it with, it all happened back 2008. Okay, 2008 when it all started, I think I had my wisdom tooth out on my left side. Then after that, after a few months, I started to hear popping and clicking on my left ear. And at first it doesn't bother me much. It doesn't hurt me or anything or whatever. So I don't really mind it. But then after a while, it just kept clicking and popping. It bothers my left ear. So at that time, I told my ex-husband about it. And then he told me to see my doctor, Christina. Thank you so much. You are beautiful too. I miss your face. Okay, so I saw my dentist. And he told me that he thinks I have TMJ. And then he gave me, he told me that I needed a mouth guard to protect my jaw because I might be grinding when I sleep. Maybe. I know I don't snore. But, so he sent me a list of TMJ specialists. And he sent me a like list of TMJ specialists when we were in Arizona. And I saw one. But then at that time, they sent me to one of the colleague of the TMJ specialist. Showbiz. Oh my gosh, Mr. James, you're funny. Not really. I'm just explaining about my TMJ and my surgery on Friday because everybody's asking me. So it's better for me to just do a live video and explain to everybody now. So I don't need to keep telling everybody, you know. So anyway. So I saw this doctor, the TMJ specialist, and they told me I do have a TMJ. They gave me a mouth guard, custom mouth guard, and thankfully our insurance at that time is paying for it. So they gave me a what you call it? The mouth guard on the bottom and then on top that I have to wear even on daytime and in the nighttime. And then I remember one time I was having lunch with a girlfriend and we were in the restaurant and oh, by the way, whenever you see me doing this, I'm stretching my neck because that means I am in so much pain right now. That's what's going on. Oh man. Okay. So we were talking about something and I get so mad. I get really, really mad from what I remember. Some of the stuff is what happened in the past was kind of blurry to me. But and I'll tell you later why. But I remember at that time we were talking and I get so upset. And I just like I think I was grinding. I get so upset and then I kind of yelled a little, like just one time, and I just like grind, and then I just locked close. I hear a pop on my left ear, and then I just locked close, and then I cannot open my mouth anymore at that time, unfortunately. So my eyes were like so big at that time because I cannot talk because my jaw was locked while the mouth guard is inside my mouth. And then I have to text my girlfriend who was right in front of me at the table telling her I think my jaw is locked and that I think I need to go see my doctor because I cannot move my mouth. It was locked closed. I cannot even make noises, I think, from what I remember, because it was so painful to move my mouth. Hey Brian, how are you? Miss you, brother. And then after that, I had to ask her to call my doctor using my phone, explain what's going on. So we, instead of finishing our lunch, I think we didn't even start our lunch, we drove to the doctor, my doctor at that time. They seen me, they try to fix what's going on. I was locked close with my mouth guard on. I was locked jaw. Yeah, that's really fucked up. And then so what happened was they tried to put, from what I remember, this is 2008, they tried to put a local anesthetic on my left jaw and also some medication, maybe a steroid or something, to open it. But the problem is because I'm awake while they're doing that arthrocentesis, I think that's how they call it. So even if they put the local anesthetic on my mouth, try putting some rubbing alcohol on the jaw. Nope, it's not gonna work. That alcohol, even alcohol will not help much. Maybe a little bit to relax me, but no, not on the pain because it was really fucked up. But anyway, thank you, Brian. So while they're trying to open my jaw at that time, I was fighting it because I was awake. They're able to open it, but what happened was it did actually, I think, dislocate my jaw already at that time. When that the first lockjaw in 2008, and I know you're crazy, Brian. Hi, Trisha. And then so they're able to open my jaw at that time, 2008, when the first time I locked jaw, but and they gave me a another custom mouth guard to help me align my jaw, whatever. But I did not have the popping or clicking on my jaw anymore at that time, but it was locked, I think, already, and it was a little bit painful. But then again, try some duct tape next time. No, did not work. Will not even work. Sorry, Brian. But what happened after is that, like, it's locked, I think, closed already permanently in that position. Maybe it got dislocated or whatever. Maybe. But I did not hear the popping anymore. But I noticed the difference with between my joint. This moves. This doesn't move. If you even feel it with the joint, you can feel it whenever you talk, you eat. When you touch both sides, you will feel there is movement in here, and there was no movement in here. Because what happened was, let me explain. A regular or a normal jaw will be looking like this, right? This is the socket, which is going to be this part over here where your ear is. And this is your jaw, for example. And there's a little bit of like a space in it every time. So let's say this is your jaw. This is this, right? And this is the joint, the socket. So there's a little space. So every time you talk or you eat and you move it, it moves like this, right? So it's just, that's the normal way. But what happened to my left side is, this one is a little bit okay, but there's still space, but it's not like really not that normal. This part over here, which is my left side, is like this. No space anymore. This is the socket. This is my jaw. There is no space anymore. So what happened is when I talk, this is the jaw, for example, whenever I talk, whenever I eat, it kept grinding and grinding on my the socket, which is right here, right? Or actually, it's on my left, but I'm just saying this. That's how it looked like. And so it kept grinding and grinding. So it pushes, it put pressure on the socket. And then there's the eardrum, which is on my left side. So what happened was I have pain in my left ear. So my eardrum really hurts so bad when I talk, when I eat, which is the regular thing that you do every day. And it feels like there is a pen or a Q-tip stuck in your eardrum permanently. That's how it feels. When it's really like, you know, even if they put medication or shots, it's not gonna help because that's the pain and that's how my joint looked like. Now, so what happened was too, so that was 2008, I ignore it, 2009, 10. From what I remember, they gave me a lot of medication also at that time to kind of calm me down because they said if I'm stressing out, if I have problems, I grind and it's just caused too much pressure on my joint, so it's just making it worse and then the pain spreads out. That's what they explained to me. So they gave me all these pills, muscle relaxant, pain reliever, and anti-anxiety pill, and antidepressant pill back in the day. So that's why I don't remember a lot of things back in the days, like 8 to 10 years ago, because it's kind of blurred to me. And then the next thing that happened was I had my kid, 2010, my youngest child. I was only, I think, 90 pounds. And 90 to 95 pounds is my regular weight. I was about 140 when I had my youngest son on the 37-week, I mean, before I push him out. And then within 3 months, I did actually lose a lot of weight already because I didn't know I was severely depressed. So I'm losing a lot of weight, even though I eat a lot and I do everything. I just like kept losing my weight and I was like 82 pounds. And I know I have the pain in my left jaw already, but I kept ignoring it because I guess because of the medications that I'm taking at that time, I don't really feel much the pain, or I just learned how to tune it out. I think that's what's going on. So after that, around 2013 and then 2014 is that when is, I think, the worst year for me. I I was still dealing with my depression, I think, at that time. Taking some meds that my doctor prescribed to me and the muscle relaxant to help the pain for my jaw. Then I had a trauma, 2013 and 2014. And this is what it made it worse. I had a ex-boyfriend, a rebound boyfriend, how I call him at that time. I was so naive. I was so stupid. And I know I'm very codependent. I'm a person that I like try to help everybody, fix everybody's problem, and I forget I have my own problem. And I'm busy, from what I remember at that time, I'm so busy with my career, my salon. I'm happy with my salon, I'm happy with my business, I'm happy with my kids. But of course, there are some things lacking at that time. And this guy had I was a victim of domestic violence 2013 and 2014, and it's very, very hard for me to tell people because I'm very embarrassed, scared, and that I feel so stupid, and I don't trust anybody anymore. Sometimes it's too hard for me to tell people about the reason why this jaw thing happened, but I know that's one of the reasons why I have to have this surgery. I'm like, I'm healed outside, that nobody can see the pain outside, or you know, the wound outside or whatever, because I can easily hide it. But inside, I am fucked up. Unfortunately. I'm trying to remember. What really happened at that time. And sometimes it's still a little blurry. Or maybe I'm trying to forget it. Because it's so painful. But it kept haunting me back. And what I learned from my therapist, seeing my therapist, and she did help me a lot to heal physically and mentally and emotionally. She helped me to forgive and to forgive myself, and also to like it helped me to accept what happened and to find help after. When I was with this person, and I know some of my friends in Facebook remember this guy, and And I tried to hide it so bad, every abuse that he had done, in spite of me being such a good woman and helping her, helping him with everything. I was literally like a sugar mama. I'm stupid. But I was so naive and I was so stupid. And from what I remember, I think it happened 3 times, I think. The first one, like, it was such a blur. All I remember was just trying to get away from the situation. But the second time was, I think I was in a restaurant or a bar that is close to my salon, meeting up some friends, and then we've broken up already at that time. I've broken up to him many times, and then he found me there, from what I remember. And then he's trying to ask me, who are these people talking to me or whatsoever. And you know, I explained it was, you know, my friends, my clients. I remember him, I think the last thing I remember is trying to get away from him and walking away and trying to go to my car. I drove away from the restaurant because my salon is just on the other side of 59. So I went to go to my salon to grab something, and he followed me there still. Before I even get out of my, even before I get into my salon, hi Sherry. Before I even get to my salon, he followed me there, and I remember trying to tell him to get away from me, stop following me, I don't want to talk to you, and all that. And I remember him grabbing me from the driver's side. And I try to close the door. I get into my car again, because when I was trying to go to my salon, I saw him on the back getting out from his car. And so I try to close the salon right away so I can go back to my car. And as I go to my car, he was following me and trying to grab me. And I was trying to, like, you know, push him away. And I was only like 82 pounds at that time. And he's like 230 pounds, I think, 6'4 or 6'2. While I'm trying to get away from him, pushing him away, because I tried to close the door of my car, I was trying to get away my arms from him, but he's 6'4, I think, or 6'2, and I'm like 5'4, 82 pounds at that time. I'm not 82 anymore, but like very underweight and very, very skinny. And people that knows me saw how I looked like back in the day. And I was able to take my arm away from him and trying to kick him out so I can close the door. But what happened was, because I was so skinny and he's, you know, stupid, he grabbed my leg, and just like pulled my leg out from the car. So I fell on the ground, hitting my back of my head and over here. And I remember passing out for a minute. And I remember at that time, I was trying to wake myself up. Telling myself to wake up, Angel, because you need to get away there. And the thing I did, and I think when he saw me in the ground, he was worried. But I used that time to get away from him. I got up, even though I was like so dizzy still, and then I get inside the car and lock the door right away and try to get away from the salon right away. And I was all bruised up, swollen. But because it's on my back and over here, so people doesn't really see it. So it's not really obvious, I guess. But I got scratches on my back and the back of my head, close to my jaw, my left side, from what I remember. And then, because I'm so stupid and naive, giving everybody chances, I did, you know, like, didn't do anything. I did not press charges or anything because I don't want him to get in trouble or whatever. I don't want people to find out what happened at that time. About, I think, a few months after, I think 2 months after, we've broken up already. I've broken up with him already, but he was trying hard to get back, whatever. And I remember going to a fundraising, a Filipino fundraising at that time, to support a friend at this karaoke place in Westheimer or something. And I think he found out that I'm there, and he went over there too. And I usually don't drink outside, especially because I'm always a designated driver, but I did have some drinks, and he was there, and I remember him, like, you know, try to talk me on about things, and then he said that he will drive me back home. And the last thing I remember at that time was I thought I was dreaming at that moment. I thought I was just dreaming. But I woke up. Someone is choking me. I thought I was dreaming. I thought it was just a nightmare. But it was not. And I told myself, Angel, you have to wake up. This is real. And so he's on top of me, and I'm looking at him, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on here? Why are you doing this to me? And then I just remember, I think, I remember what my ex-husband taught me also, because he's a better way. He taught me how to, it's like some self-defense at that time. And he told me, if someone's choking you, the other thing you can do is, like, you do this. You push it around, like, in between, and then we'll be able to get out from it. And then I tried that. I tried it at that time, and it did work, thankfully. And I kicked him out the bed that time, and he still tried to go to me, and then I fell in the bed and I hit my head on the dresser, I think, or the armoire or something like that. And I know I was bleeding already at that time. I was bleeding and I was crawling away from the bed and the dresser while I'm bleeding. And I remember feeling my eyes is trying, it started to shut close. And then he come up to me and said, and he looked at me like he just woke up, and asking me, what happened to you? Who did that to you? And I'm like so shocked, and I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? You did this to me. Don't go near me. Don't stay away from me. I'm so confused, so scared, and passing out. Then I was able to run out the house, grab my my purse, I think. I remember. Good thing that my car keys is inside my purse still. I think I ran half naked, I think, outside the house because I was like half naked. I don't remember why I'm half naked. But I was able to grab my pants and my shirt. I think it was on top of my purse. And then I went inside my car and I locked my car right away. And he was outside banging the door asking me if he can help me. He was begging me to help me, and I think from what I remember is that I remember my kids, I remember my mom, I remember my ex, what they gonna tell me, and that they will, my ex will use that against me, how stupid I am to be in that situation. Take my kids away from me. So he drove me to emergency room in Sugar Land. I was interviewed by a police officer, I remember, and the nurses over there, but I have to lie because I was so scared that if anybody finds out that my ex will use that against me, so I will not see my kids, or like they will judge me, and then, you know, it was just so scary and embarrassing. And I told my clients, I went to work, I remember I went to go stay in a hotel for a while, away from everybody, and everybody asking me how I am, where I am, because I was not, I closed my salon for a few days, because I was so swollen and bruised. And stitches. And then, you know, going to work with sunglasses and all concealer on my face so they will not see my bruise, my black eye. I have to see an eye doctor also after. It was a mess. So, I mean, a few months after, my stitches, the bruises are gone. But I didn't know that inside it's all fucked up already. My jaw is dislocated already. I didn't even know. And because I was very depressed, I was just trying to like forget all the pain that I'm feeling at that moment. So anyway, so that's what happened. That trauma from that person made my jaw worse. That is why now it's destroyed. That is now why it is dislocated. That is now why I have to have my joint replacement on Friday. Something that I have not spoken for so long. And I'm not open to tell people because I'm very embarrassed. But this is really important for people who's gone through those stuff also, or going through shit like that. Domestic violence is a no-no. You have to speak up. You have to talk about it. It still will haunt you back. Another way. Look at me. I'm all like, look okay outside, but I'm actually fucked up inside. And it's so hard to mask it all the time. Makeup will not mask all the pain all the time. Dressing up will not change anything. People will always ask me, why are you always looking so cute, Angel? Why are you always dressing up so nice? All of me. It's because I'm doing it so they will not see the pain that I have every day. What I feel, because all they see is the
outer appearance you shown to them, but if they only know the pain that I have every day that I have to go through, it's so painful that sometimes I just cry myself to sleep and praying and hoping that it will go away and I will not feel it again the next time I woke up, but I still have it. But now I am not afraid anymore to tell people what really happened, because I want people that have gone through like that also or going through that to speak up. Because it's not okay. It's not okay. And I'm just so blessed and glad that I have someone who is there for me and help me heal emotionally, mentally, and now physically, will support me so I will be better. And I'm so thankful for my husband, Nick. Because if it's not for him, I will not even try to take good care of myself.
There you go, y'all now know the reason of why my joint is really fucked up. But all I'm gonna say though, that even though the past was even so painful to remember, and sometimes it still triggers me, you have to learn to accept what happened in the past. Learn from it and move on. And be an inspiration to others. So it won't happen to them. Or inspire them that in spite of what happened to them in the past, it's gonna be okay, right? There is still solutions and you could be okay. You just need to take some time to take good care of yourself first, so you can take good care of others around you. I didn't mean to be emotional, but I guess it just... Sometimes I get upset with myself whenever I think about what happened at that time, the past. Did I did that to myself because I'm so naive and stupid? If I did something, maybe this is not gonna happen to me. It's pretty scary. But I'm trying to look on the positive thing that I will not have, hopefully. I'll have a pain-free days in the future, and I don't need to mask the pain every time to people. So, to end this, I just want to tell people, like, not because you guys see those people like always smiling and they look okay and they look fine, that doesn't mean they're not hurting. Sometimes those are the people like trying so hard to be strong.
But sometimes you guys have to be very understanding also and be sympathetic. We need more love and not hate, especially nowadays, right? Anyway, I hope you guys
got a little bit of a answer to those some questions that you guys have for me. So I'm asking for prayers next week, and I'll have my surgery on Friday. If
I will have my COVID test on Monday, hopefully it will be negative so I could get my surgery on Friday.
I have to be in the Herman Hospital at 5:30 in the morning. My surgery time is 7:30. So just to update again, what they're gonna do, they said, is that they will cut here and then over here and then around my ears, so they will have to shave part of my hair. So maybe I'll have a little bit of new hairstyle after. I don't know, but I don't really care much at this moment about it, even though I will miss my hair. Hopefully they will not cut all my hair. And they will cut the joint from here to here and the socket right here, because that one is really destroyed already, and they will put a prosthetics. And I will have wired on my mouth shot to align my this jaw to this jaw, and that in with that said, I will have a liquid diet for maybe 4 to 8 weeks, or the soft diet, I guess. But anyway, so I will be out of commission for a few weeks. I will be in the hospital for 3 days, or 2 nights and 3 days, and so maybe y'all can still text me or message me, and I wanna be able to talk, but I could always just message you back when I'm feeling much better to reply. Keep praying for me. Hopefully I will not have a panic attack. It's kind of scary sometimes whenever I think about it. It's major. Because I know, I mean, and now I didn't realize how our jaw is very important. Of course, when we talk and when we eat, and we do that every time. I try to forgive the person who hurt me, but it takes time, especially what happened now. He is out there and he might see this video, or his friends or his family might see this video. He tried to contact me a few months ago and I blocked him. Yes, you see this? Stay away from me, please. I don't want you to hear from you. Just leave me alone. If you ever see this, you know who you are. Anyway, that's all for now. It's not supposed to be this. Not supposed to be crying. I'm supposed to be like just explaining what happened and why do I have this TMJ, and what's gonna happen to my surgery, and then I'm like all like crying. Oh my god. Anyway, sorry about that. I hope that explains everything already. Just needed your prayers, and thank you for everybody who messaged me right now. You know who you are. Thank you for prayers, and to those true friends, thank you for keeping in touch with me and messaging me. I know I've been out of the loop lately. You'll know why. but for those true friends, thank you so much. I love you all, and I hope everybody stays safe. stay positive, and please, good deed, to just share the love. And let's just stop the hate. It's getting toxic. Alright, y'all. I hope you guys have a good weekend. I am so sorry again for this venting, or supposed to be explaining about the TMJ and the surgery and become venting, because I have to tell you all the reason. For those who just got here, and you can just always rewind it, I guess. Yes, Jay said, you have a husband that loves you. Yes, he does love me so much, and I'm so, so thankful for having him. Because he's been my rock through all this. Ninang Esme, thank you. I love you too, and thank you for praying. Aurora, yes, thank you. I try to be badass. It's hard. Brian, thank you for praying. Nelson. Oh, my half-sister, Rona. Thank you for the message. Anyway, I can't go back all the way up to those people who messaged me, but thank you so much. And anyway, I think I'm done. Thank you so much. I love you all. Stay positive in life, not COVID. And thank you for watching. Thank you for being there for me. Thank you for praying for me. And continue to pray for me. I miss everybody so much. I miss the happy hour. I miss seeing everybody without, mask. And I miss going to events and seeing all the friends. And just hanging out and not worrying about COVID. But I hope everybody is staying safe. And for those like sick, I hope you feel better. And I will pray for you all. Continue to pray for me. I love you all so much. And see y'all next time. Bye for now.